when I first moved here to Westport, I had a cell phone, and I used to have to go down to the end of the dock in our local area to call anybody. So this is an advancement. Let's only put it that way. We're really excited that you're here. My name is Deborah Weaver. I'm from the Watershed Alliance, and I'm sure most of you might have seen me or know me, and I thank you for being here. We're really excited to have Mark Bertness from Brown University here. He's going to talk about salt marsh degradation, why it's happening, and how it's intersecting with our local communities. And I know this is something that all of us here really care a lot about. Recently, there was some photographic research on how much salt marsh had sort of crumbled away in the West Branch, and it's very frightening to see that and to see this beautiful area diminished in any way. And I know we all care a lot about it, so I appreciate you being here tonight. I'm going to read a little bit about Mark, because he's a pretty cool guy. I called him when I was looking for a speaker for our annual meeting, and he said, well, you know, I'd love to talk, but I'm busy that day. And I said, okay, so when aren't you busy? So that's how he came here tonight, because tonight he amazingly wasn't busy. He's a professor at Brown. He's the Robert Brown Professor of Biology, Ecology, and Evolutionary Biology at Brown University, and he's been doing a lot of research in the whole area of biology around salt marshes, around conservation, coastal ecology, and his research focuses on the processes that structure natural communities and applying this knowledge to informing coastal conservation. He's also interested in the role of positive interactions in community organizations and the mechanics of understanding community assembly rules and the necessary actions to predict and remediate problems in local communities and the impact of human disturbance. So he's kind of really right up the area of what we're all very interested in, and we're really honored to have him here tonight. So thank you so much for being here. We have literature in the back if you'd like to find out more about our organization. We have a few things coming up very soon, including our annual meeting on March 26th, and this weekend an art show, a winter art show at the Shattuck Gallery on Saturday, which we'd love to invite you to. But tonight is Mark's night to help educate us and illuminate us on issues that I know we're all really concerned with. So thank you so much for being here.
Thanks a lot. I'm going to talk to you tonight about general salt marsh degradation. Some of the work that we've been doing in my lab over the last over a decade, actually, and a lot of this has focused on Cape Cod, but it's broader than that. So I won't be talking specifically about your backyard, but I can guarantee you that your backyard fits into what we're going to be talking about. And I'm going to talk to you about it in terms of how we're trying to understand human impact. One of the big problems we have in marine ecology and conservation biology is that we're barely getting to the point where we can study or understand single impact at a time. You know, we have an idea of how eutrophication works and why mechanistically it drags in phragmites and all that kind of thing. We have a good idea of a lot of specific things, but how they actually interact. None of these things happen in isolation. And so we don't really know whether they're additive, whether they counteract each other, or whether they act synergistically and just set off big explosions of problems. One of my former students who's out in California now recently did a literature review to kind of, which is always a lousy way to test something, but this is the only way that we could at this point. And I'll tell you about a study that we've done here about this, but her literature review, as much as I put it down, said that the most common response to multiple stressors is synergistic. You know, so that it's not a 1 + 1 = 2, it's a 1 + 1 = 5, 6, 10. And this is really what we're facing. You know, it's, and when we talk about individual problems, we're simplifying it so we can kind of understand it, but it doesn't really help us understand how they'll interact. So I'm gonna kind of wrap I'll give you a background on salt marsh die-off, which is what we're seeing in Cape Cod now, and then I'll talk a little bit about how we think that's going to interact with sea level rise over the next 50 years, and how can we actually approach this experimentally to find out some answers. So, first of all, you have to kind of start off from the beginning. If you want to talk about consumer control of marshes in the Western Atlantic, which is what I'm going to give you an idea about, you have to have the understanding that 30, 20 years ago, salt marshes were thought to be totally controlled by physical factors, temperature, salinity, nutrients, and this was the old salt marsh paradigm could really be called the Odom doctrine. Gene Odom wrote the first ecology book back in 1972, so that there was an ecology course before then. Ecology is a young science. That's why it's a interesting science, because there's so much that we don't know. But the Odom doctrine was based primarily on correlations, you know, correlations between these physical factors and structure and of these communities. And correlations really are not a good way to go, you know. You know, think about if somebody made correlations about, you know, your life and how much time you spend with people. Well, then you people you work with, it leads you down bad paths. So we started adding a number of years ago when I came to Brown was adding an experimental approach on top of testing some of these ideas that had popped out of the Odom doctrine that had never been properly tested. So the first, and let me say this about the Odom doctrine. So total control by physical factors. You know, if put the physical factors, then you have the field of dreams. If you build it, they'll come. Consumers, trophic interactions, food interactions made no difference. Now, this approach came out of Yale and G. Evelyn Hutchinson's group. One of his students started this, but also the experimental community ecology groups that thought species mattered, that also came out of G. Evelyn Hutchinson's group. So the bottom line was this Odom doctrine was a correlative approach that was born in New Haven back in the late 50s, early 60s, and developed by Odom down on Sapelo Island and the Georgia Sea Islands, courtesy of R.J. Reynolds, the cigarette guy. The first real crack in the Odom Doctrine, and let me say that too, that the Odom Doctrine and salt marshes really played a seminal role in developing the field, general field of ecosystem science. Thinking about ecosystems as kind of systems that were controlled by these physical processes that all fit into a nice little bottle with boxes with arrows going from one box to the other, all in the comfort of your own home or your office. And predators and detritivores and all that just made everything too messy to deal with. So the first real crack in the Odom Doctrine applied to salt marshes, which was then generalized to all ecosystems in general, was done by a guy named Bob Jeffries at the University of Toronto. And this Bob was a classically trained British botanist that was lured over to University of Toronto when University of Toronto kind of got mad as hell. They weren't going to take it anymore. They were going to become the best university in Canada, and they were sick and tired of McGill being called the best university in Canada. So they did it like the University of Texas, they went out and they bought it, They brought Bob over, and why would Bob, this soft-spoken, wonderful guy who unfortunately passed away just a couple years ago, why would he want to come over from Cambridge to University of Toronto? Well, his specialty was halophyte ecology, salt-loving plants. And he knew that the biggest concentration of salt-loving plants was in Siberia and up in the Canadian subarctic. So he was really excited to come over and study the halophytes here. And he was classically trained, do your work, kind of the Bill Belichick approach to science, every day, do it and do it the next year and the year after that, he was very thorough. But when he got there, this is what he found. He found all these geese there. And they were a nuisance. He wrote initially a real classic paper that and this is in the mid 70s, that demonstrated experimentally by removing geese and comparing removed areas to areas where geese forage, that geese actually increased the production of the marshes in Goose Bay by thinning them down and then cycling nutrients, i.e. pooping, on the plants, so that you had more production with the geese. And this at the time, this was a really well cited paper. And this is I'm going to show you two pictures like this. But if you live here and look at this, it kind of looks like the glaciers left, last week or a month or two ago. Glacial erratics are like, you can pick them up in your hand. Here's a big one, and then the plants. There's not a lot of soil, so the plants. Not only are they really sensitive to physical stresses in the stressful environment that has very little nutrients, high salinity because there's not enough plant cover there, and not much oxygen because all the bacteria take the oxygen out of the top layer. So they're very shallowly rooted plants, but they do cover most of the substrate, almost 100% cover. So this is what it looked like when Bob went up and started working in the Canadian subarctic. But then what happened over the next number of years was that we were pouring nitrogen in North America on agricultural fields, on soccer fields, front lawns, everything. We would have run out of nitrogen in 1890s if it hadn't been for the introduction of artificial fertilizer. So the artificial fertilizer use just was skyrocketing here, and then also that the number of acres under cultivation was also going up, and the geese loved this. You know? we're having a pretty good geese here this year. Mm. You know, so the geese, they're down in North America, grazing on green patches, and then they're going up to the Arctic to have their babies. So here's what the geese population looked like, and these are snow geese. The same kind of thing is going on in Siberia, and these geese, it's not just geese, but a lot of other herbivores, a lot of mammalian herbivores. Also, if you fertilize a big patch of grass, they'll just walk by everything else and go like right to it, like it's cholesterol or like it's bacon or something, they'll totally discriminate against the low productivity stuff. We did llama removals in Argentina, and the llamas and the cattle wanted in so badly they would rip their flesh open just to get at the grass inside the cage. It was just crazy. I mean, it's so the geese are flying over. They see your soccer field. They see they just zero right in on it They see the edges of it and the whole nine yards. So and what they are is like what these geese are. Is they don't nibble like a lawnmower at the green stuff. They're grubbing herbivores. They go for the rhizomes and the roots, the really luscious stuff. So here's what this looked like after 5 years.
Oh my God!
This looks like a lunar landscape. These are the same rocks, and these are patches that he managed to save. He could never go out there without spotters because the predators there are polar bears, and polar bears, they're natural predators of humans, and like white sharks and a couple other things, but they'll get down on all fours and they'll crawl until they get about 100 meters away, and then they'll break into a 30-mile-an-hour run so you have to have a spotter to even work up here. And then now that they have nothing to eat, they just kind of wander around town. Really kind of scary stuff. So that was the first crack. The second thing that happened was that happened in the early 80s. In the 90s, all of a sudden there were marsh die-offs that were being reported in on the Georgia Sea Island, the Sapo Island, where ecosystem ecology was born, and the Gulf Coast, and at the same time they were having all kinds of problems with some of the things that they were harvesting too. They were blue crabs were being over harvested. They were being harvested to such low densities that the disease would ultimately get to them. So we went down to start investigating this die-off that was going on. And this is Keenan Field on Sapo Island. This is a huge marsh that's 390 acres or so. The marshes there are really, really large. And these are the natural drainage ditches that are draining. And if you look closely, you'll see that around the creeks, you have tall grass, and by tall grass there, this stuff's 2 meters tall. And then behind the tall grass, you have short stunted stuff that's darker. And it's darker because it's not all grass. It's a lot of bare space true. And if you kind of Google in on something like that and take a closer look, what you find is that you have substrate that's fairly bare, plants that are fairly short in stature, that look like they're dying or not in very good shape, and around the edges of this big bare area, you have snail densities of 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 per meter square, and they're moving across this patch like sea urchins moving across a kelp forest, just kind of mowing down everything in their way, and this is characteristic. We've traveled around. This is characteristic of these southern marshes. It's not an odd kind of thing. So, but nobody ever tested. This is the explanation for this was that this is a harsh adapic or harsh soil that was killing these plants or making these plants struggle, and as they were struggling, these detritivore snails would come in and kind of clean up the boxes in their mop, you know, kind of thing. So we decided, Brian Selman and I. Brian is the one of my former students, who's the Rachel Carson Professor of Conservation Biology at Duke now. But this is when he was just a young buck. We did this work, I guess about 15 years ago. But we went out went down to Sapo Island, you know, right where this all started, and we put out these large cages. These are a meter across, basically at least here in the high marsh, big meter cubes of hardware cloth where we could and galvanize hardware cloth. You know, basically snails, they don't look where they're going, they kind of lick where they're going. So if you put a heavy metal in front of them, they turn around, you know, whether it's copper fouling paint or galvanized zinc, they'll avoid it. So as long as you can outsmart them and you put the poles in the right place so they're not conveyor belts letting new ones in, you can manipulate densities in these things. So we did this in a highly replicated fashion at two marshes, did this both in the high marsh and the low marsh where the grass is really tall, And then we also did it a smaller number of replicates at eight marshes around the marsh, around Sapelo, just to look at generality. And the results were really pretty amazing. After only 3 months, you know, put these cages out in May and before it got so hot that you couldn't stand there. At the end of July, we went and we monitored. So here's a snails at mean density. I call it mean educated density. You know, so that if you do a mean density in good snail habitat on Sapelo, the mean density is 1,000 snails per meter square. So this is 1,000 meters per square, basically normally the way it looks. If you take those snails away, you get a order of magnitude increase in the productivity. So it goes up 100%. But this is nothing compared to what happened in the low marsh. Now, the low marsh is what people oftentimes refer to is one of the most productive, if not the most productive, natural ecosystem on the planet. You know, they compare it to rice fields, but rice fields are cultivated. But they're right up there in terms of productivity. What happened when we took here's your 3 meter tall two meter tall cordgrass at its normal densities on the edge. Here's what happens when you put 1,000 snails in them after just 3 months, and here's what happens when you put 500 in after 3 months. And this situation looks like this. Basically, everything dead above and below ground. Nothing left. Turns out it's a combination of straight herbivory and also the scarring that they do at low densities. Lower densities, these snails actually are fungal farmers, you know, kind of cheesemakers. You know, they scrape the blades with their radula, and then these radulations. Brian's a southerner, so he has to think up names or sort of things. So on these radulations, you get fungus growing, and then they defecate on the fungus, and it enhances it and grows more. But then when you get lots of snails, which happens when you remove the predators a lot, then they die from a combination of herbivory and fungal infection. You know, so you desire combination of herbivory and disease. So this is from the first big paper we published on this from Sapelo is basically a trophic cascade. Here's the date if you're interested on the left. But here's basically the story. These same newspapers that were announcing the diophany salt marsh were talking about the bad crab season and all the crab disease. Blue crabs are a big business there. They were having they're being over harvested, and also the snapping turtles have a population. They're ecologically extinct. You can find them, but ecologically they're not abundant enough to really play the role they used to. And what this does is this releases this snail from consumer control. When it gets at high densities, it destroys the marsh. So this is a typical what's called a trophic cascade, which is something Bob Payne, the starfish god, wrote a paper about in 1966. And Bob was kind of the marsh people were kind of enemies, you know. So the marsh stuff stayed ecosystem perspective, and the Rocky Shores and kelp forests were community perspective, and they didn't talk a lot. So we wanted to know, what's going on in marshes that haven't been worked in before? You know, where do we have some kind of neutral place to look? And we knew from Wallace's writing that Argentinian marshes just north of Patagonia were really common in the Mar del Plata area. So sounded like a lot of fun. So we went down to work on Argentinian marshes. Most I tease about this, but it was really it was a lot of fun to do. But we were training PhD students down there too. So it was a very rewarding thing to do, starting a marine ecology and coastal conservation in Argentina. But when we got there, you know, what we found was the whole mid part of the high marsh was just totally burrowed by this crab. And this was not a little crab. This is a crab, you know, with a carapace that wide that you didn't want to let pinch your finger. It was everywhere. It was like an ant farm, except with these things. And so it looked very much like the Georgia marshes, except with crabs. When in doubt, you do an experiment, right? So we did a simple experiment with one of our new PhD students, who's now a professor down at the Catholic University of Santiago in Chile. But what we did is we just took the marsh grass in the high marsh, and we transplanted it back into its own habitat, or down into this bare area. And in this bare area, we either left it out on its own or we put it in a cage. And within a month, the stuff in the cage grew better than it did back in its own habitat. The stuff not in a cage ended up being just kind of, you know, morning after stubble kind of thing. And this happened very quickly, just in a couple weeks. So then, you know, this kind of brings us up to about 2000 or so, and the work that we had been doing in Georgia and the Gulf Coast had been making some waves, and the ecosystems people down there were really kind of, you know, we had become kind of the center of their dartboard, and we started getting, there were a lot of stuff on the internet about, oh, this is happening and that's happening, then there starts to be comments and little meetings about die-off on New England marshes, particularly in Cape Cod. Initially, you know, my response to this was like, wait a minute, I was at that marsh yesterday, you know, they would post pictures, and you'd look at the picture and go, no, that's a rack area that was killed with rack. That's not marsh die-off. There was a lot of kind of salt marsh McCarthyism going on about kind of red baiting, you know, New England marshes, and they had a meeting at Plum Island about it, and I told my students, no way I'm going to that, and they ended up dragging me there, and I got so provoked. I got up and talked a little bit about it, and then the next year they said, okay, This year, we're going to have the same meeting, but there will be no talk of alternate hypotheses or herbivores. I'm serious. I mean, just crazy stuff that, you know, until very recently, you never thought would ever happen. But so I finally get this one guy from the Cape Cod National Seashore, Steve Smith. I'm not making that up. And he said, no. I totally agree, but we have something going on here. You need to see this. And we ran through it. And I said, do you have crabs there? And he said, yeah, we have crabs here. But you know, I had written a paper back in the 80s about how crabs facilitate, you know, marsh grass. So if they thought, oh, crab, that makes them happy, right? These are different crabs. I said, the crabs that I'm talking about are nocturnal crabs. And oh, that's a problem. He's a government employee. That was after hours. And it's not necessarily by choice. It's like they're not allowed, you know, to make other people look bad. So finally, after about a month of negotiation, I get a call from him. He said, and he sent me pictures. He said, I had students go out and they're all over the place. And this is what here's Caesarum reticulatum. Here's its the opening to its burrows. And you notice that there's never just one burrow opening. There are always multiple burrow openings. But when you have the larger burrow openings, you always see this stubble where they clearly just munched the grass right down. And then if you go and look at what it looks like on more of a landscape or habitat view, what you see is marshes that look like they've been just kind of look like Swiss cheese, that are totally pockmarked, so that maybe 40% of the below ground space is burrows, air, but this is in dense peat. And then you have an active area of burrowing, and the burrows extend down into the lower part here. But then this is receding here. There's kind of a big receding hairline as they live there. And these crabs, when you look at these crabs, think back to the 60s. These are communal crabs that live in large, large communes together, and there are little pockets here, little pockets there. Everything but the shag rug, you know, kind of thing. And so if you look, and it takes you a while to kind of get a feel for this, but you know, when I first came to New England and was working in marshes in Narragansett Bay, which now is ravaged like this, but I knew where this crab was. You know, there would be a patch maybe half the size of this table, or two in every marsh. And I knew, you know, I don't know really why, but they were really isolated to a couple little areas. Now, in a marsh like this, that burrow complex or commune is interconnected the whole way. You know, just, yeah.
When you first came here to Narragansett Bay and you saw these small areas and you can't see the nocturnal crabs, how did you know that's what was there? Did somebody show it to you? Did the local people know?
No, I would go out at night, of course.
Yeah, but I'm just curious, was it locally known by anybody?
No, people knew about biologists, serious biologists knew that Caesarum was there, but it was a minor component. It was just not common. But what people didn't realize is that they were being pinned down to these areas by predators. So of course, once we realized that, you know, as soon as I saw this, you know, I'd seen this movie before. I mean, this was just like Argentina. All over again, a little bit of a spatially a little different species. This is a communal thing, not a solitary thing like we have down south. So we started looking around to see how common it was. And first of all, we got to make sure experimentally that it's a that's predation that's going on. So we devise this technique that we could deploy all over the Cape and fix up at Brown and then come out here and deploy it. But we would just roll cores of cordgrass up in hardware cloth sleeves and put them in core holes and then monitor them over time. And within a couple of weeks, these would be gone and these would be just fine. So how common was this? So when we started looking around and we found that if you wanted, there were marshes where in terms of extent of die-off, the linear extent, how much the coastline has been affected was almost 100%. And we could monitor grazing intensity just by randomly counting the number of tillers. That's what you call just one of the leaves of these guys. Had chew marks on them where it had been grazed down. So there was like 80% of the variation among marshes was explained by grazing intensity. And grazing intensity, 60% was explained by the number of Sesarma we caught in drop traps. Just drop traps, technical name for tennis ball cans sunk in the marsh. So this is definitely what was going on. Was it predation that was driving this? Was it, you know, the predation from the water column, predation in the low marsh? To look at this, we went out, gathered. There's sites where Sesarma was really common. Gathered hundreds of Sesarma. Usually from inside the Cape Cod Natural Seashore, because this is back when they thought that they could actually, you know, beat this crab. So they thought we were doing them a favor by taking it away. And then we go back to the lab and, you know, listen to music and tie these crabs onto little tethers of fishing line. You've all seen, you know, mothers with their kids on a little like that. So and we would go to marshes where there wasn't die-off happening, and marshes where there was die-off happening, and where there wasn't die-off happening, these you would have almost all of them gone in one tidal cycle. You'd set them out in the evening, and you come back in the morning, and if the tide had come up, they were all gone. At the die-off sites, you know, they would be just setting up shop, you know, hanging out, eating, you know, talking to their friends. I mean, they were fine. We left them out there just to see how long they'd last, and we let them leave them out there tethered up for the summer. As long as they were had a little bit of shade, they were fine. So then, now I'm skipping a couple steps here because I'm afraid I have to admit to you, these are a couple of the steps that you probably would have really liked to know. Yeah. You know, but let me, I'll just give you the short story of, you know, the Wetland Protection Act, you know, kicked in the 70s, right? It's 1974. But what they didn't realize is before they did that, they had set up all the infrastructure, all the docks, all the slips, all the marinas and everything. They were already there. It was done. It's a done deal. Because as soon as that infrastructure was set up, you had all these fishermen coming out here to take all the predators out of the water. They took the predators out of the water, and Sarma went crazy and ate the marshes. So of course people were like, no way, you know, that's just crazy. Not my backyard. And it was particularly sensitive because the backyard was Woods Hall, you know, so. And I would be embarrassed too if it happened like at Brown, you know, right in my backyard. So what we did is we saw, once we had gone and looked at a series of marshes, we saw marshes with lots of die-off and then marshes without die-off, and not a whole lot in between. I mean, there were ones that were on their way, but it was pretty cut and dry. And when we saw marshes that were really heavily hit, you know, there was always a fishing ramp. There were boats there. There was fishing access. And when we saw nice marshes, they were in reserves. They were in areas where people would point guns at us if we went tried to get into that property to look at it. You know, they were restricted areas and so we picked out seven of each, and then we did a series of experiments on them. We looked at Sarma densities at marinas, and undeveloped areas. We looked at cordgrass grazing at marinas and at undeveloped areas, and then the percent of the creek bank die off. And very clearly, more 5 times as many Sarma, you know, in the marina areas, you know, like 3 times the number of grazing, the grazing intensity, and you know, 5 times the extent of grazing. And then we also went back to these same marshes and we did tethering experiments and we did total inventories of biomass of consumers. We found at the undeveloped areas they had much higher predator biomass, the very low survivorship again of these tethered crabs, and then big difference in Sarma density as well. But we still, that's still kind of corkage. It's experiments at and over a correlation. You know, we didn't actually do the Bob Payne. We removed the predators and saw the response, which I'm kind of a stickler about. So we did that. It was a pretty risky thing to do because with the winters around here and what the ice can do to the stuff in the intertidal. But we decided, we went to a place where there had been a significant recovery, and there was a nice edge that we could do it on, and it was pretty extensive, so that we could work on about a 200 meter stretch of marsh, and we put out predator removal cages, which were basically just kind of aquamesh the lobstermen and aquaculture people use, totally covering the top, the sides, and then sunk down into the substrate about 25, 30 centimeters so things couldn't burrow under it. Then cage controls, which had the structure but not the sides, and then unmanipulated controls. And with plants, if you get a photographic result, you know, that you can actually see without doing stats, that's a pretty strong result. And this is what we saw.
that when we removed the predators, you know, we saw lots of bare space, lots of nibbling and normally, with the controls, everything was fine. And here's the data behind that. And we had to divide. They were big enough cages that the burrows of these things and the herbivory is so sensitive to whether the substrate can support burrows. You know, real soft substrate, kind of a Goldilocks thing. Soft substrate, too soft. Really hard substrate, too hard. So that the top of the cage is where it's really hard, and the bottom of the cage is where it's really soft. We're different. So you can see here that in terms of cordgrass grass biomass, under the cages were both elevations were much higher biomass, and bare space was much higher in the cage than it was in the either type of control. So this was a yeah.
Can you describe the predator you're talking about?
Not really, because it's blue crabs, it's green crabs, it's bluefish, it's eels. It's like, what do you go fishing with? You know, it's like, what doesn't like a small crab? You know, it's just about anything with a big mouth. It differs geographically a little bit. I mean, as you move south, it really becomes blue crabs. Mm-hmm. You know, the southern results are almost all the blue crabs because turtles have been driven to such low numbers. But other things happen. As soon as you drive them down, then some of the other crabs that can be predators, they get important. There are lots of nuances that I'm not going to talk about.
So how does that relate to the fishing? That if it's crabs that are eating the
can I get to that, Matt? I mean, we fish for all this stuff.
Maybe you want to get to that in a minute too, but how did you establish the reduction in population of predators before you got there in the areas that were already
We looked at areas where there were the diopsin, areas where there weren't diopsin, and we sane the hell out of them and got biomass estimates. That was a hypothesis that we tested. So here we're to the point now. So here's the nice view you see if you go into that nice restaurant at Sackatucket Harbor overlooking the beautiful salt marsh. You know, and what you see here is you know how these diops progress. A lot of it's dependent on the aspect of the shore. And on steep aspect stuff, it calves off, it breaks off like you're in Glacier Bay.
Yeah.
We've done a lot of work with areas like that where big chunks will calve off and then ultimately just dissolve. But on long platforms like this, actually, Sackatucket Harbor, for those of you who know the history, used to be a big shipbuilding facility. There are things with square peg nails that are up here in the marsh. Here's stakes that we had put in, and this is how much recession we've seen of that border in just like 3 or 4 years. You know, so this is a receding hairline. Moving back this way, the crabs are—they're still occupying this, but just you know, recreational stuff. The active border where the herbivory is taking place is right along here. So,
what's going to happen when, and this isn't like if, it's when sea level rises and starts, we start seeing multi-stress interactions going on here. And you know, sometimes these are important things that we all really ought to know. Sometimes it really doesn't matter. This is an important thing because salt marshes, you know, it's, you know, I love people that think of these things as swamps, you know, because salt marshes are, in terms of ecosystem services, that means the things that we care about, coastal buffering, chemical filtering, nursery grounds, they beat the snot out of tropical rainforests, coral reefs, kelp beds. They have the people have done the economics of this, and salt marshes and mangroves are acre for acre the most valuable ecosystem service providers, i.e. what we care about, that there is. So what happens when sea level starts coming up and affecting this interaction matters, because that can make the difference between whether these marshes are there or whether they go and then the houses go, and you know, whether it goes in that direction. So we did an experiment, and this is something that's felt relatively, we're still getting it published. So this is the IPCC sea level rise thing. So we took a moderate kind of what's going to be going on in about 50 years approach, and you know, that would mean in terms of flooding, about 8% more of the marsh is going to be flooded. And here's kind of what that looks like at a place like Dennis. Just we've done historical reconstructions from aerial historic archive photographs of just about every marsh on the Cape to kind of get an idea of proximity to fishing and die off, and of course the draining of marshes during the Great Depression was, you know, if you go up to Maine, which is north of the range of Sisarma, you know, they look like they were built like dug yesterday. You know, they're straight. They were all built to specs, like half a meter wide, and now in that picture of Sacotucket, that half a meter wide drainage ditch is like 10 meters wide. You know, and it's just calving, erosion. So here's what it looks like with die-off and increased flooding of the low marsh. What we see now, so the low marsh right now comprises about 15% of total marsh area, but it's stalled that border because the substrate's too hard for them to actually dig their burrows. Years ago, I did experiments when I was thinking about this before it became a problem, and I went out with a corer, and I made a bunch of holes, and you know, kind of with a Robert Redford kind of build it and they'll come kind of thing, and they did. You know, they moved up and they found those burrows. Great burrows, no maintenance, you know, just like living in Arizona, you know, it's like don't have to take care of your lawn or anything like that, and they were there for years, you know. So what will the combined effect be? So what we did is we did this, looked at this hypothesis that short form cord grass is protected from grazing and burrowing by hard peat, the stuff that they used out on the Cape here for fuel for a while, the stuff that they mine so much of in Holland that they have to have windmills now to keep water out of the, you realize that a third of
of Holland is below ground, is below sea level. And that's because they were, during the Middle Ages, they thought they were so cool because they were taking out all the peat and shipping it to Germany. And sea level rise will expand the area that's vulnerable to die off, because it's going to soften the substrate to the point where it'll allow burrowing to occur. So how do you do this? Well, we picked a site to work at. This is here are the, you can tell the natural creeks, and you can tell the dug creeks. They're all straight kind of highways for Sesarma. But this is Colt State Park, Marsh, and I know the people out there well enough so I could talk to them and ask them to keep people out of there and to ignore the fact that there are going to be people down there taking data once a week, and that we did all this work, the hard setup in the winter when nobody was out there, when we worked out here on Cape Cod heavily. We do all our heavy setup when everybody was in Florida and nobody was around, and we didn't have to, the restaurants were closed, and we didn't have to battle all the traffic and all that kind of things. So we did a transplant experiment where we had to test the level of substrate hardness on our river. And then we did it at three elevations to mimic elevation or sea level rise. Easier said than done. Easier to talk the talk than to walk the walk on this one. So how do we soften things? Well, went to a marsh where this was a possible to do and not be a problem. We with straight edge shovels, we dug out 30 by 30 by 30 cubes of peat, which meant kind of putting this shovel straight down. And then prying them up. I still have back problems to this day because for some reason when I take my students out, I still feel that I have to do things faster than they do, which is really stupid. But it's killed my back. But I had a lot of fun doing it while I was doing it, for sure. But so we did this in the fall, and then we moved these blocks once they were already in torpor, kind of overwintering state, to the low marsh so that they would totally saturate with water like they were at a lower elevation. And then we repeated the same thing in the following spring. This is Huli Chin, and she's a faculty member at Fudan University in Shanghai, and Steve Haggerty, who's riding mountain bikes out in Oregon now. So we had hard peat and then the softened peat, and then we moved these things into different. With either ambient, I'm going to talk about ambient and control as the same thing here, but ambient, softened, hard, then caged, and caged control. And we did this, in the low marsh, here's a cage, here's one in a cage here, it's a cage here, here's a cage control, and then the ambient ones. And we're just kind of scattered around. We did this at three levels to mimic sea level rise, and we replicated it a lot because we were worried about losing treatments and being in a public place and vandalism, whether it's malicious
or unintentional. We just didn't want to put that much effort into this without and lose a bunch of replicates. And we knew that if we put actually it was 10 replicates out, that we could lose a couple and still be fine statistically. So here's what we see in the low marsh. Remember, the low marsh has nothing above ground. Okay, so here's above ground in the low zone, below ground in the low zone. Ambient has, of course, nothing above ground, never did. But below ground, turns out there are some rhizomes down there, some living rhizomes, not many. And then we found that when you caged the transplants, you got a really strong above ground signal, you know, where when you cage things, it was fine, but they got eaten down to almost nothing without cages. And but the only place that you got a below ground response was in the soft substrate, where they could easily once they got there could get at. These guys actually prefer, if you give them a preference test between above ground vegetation and below ground vegetation, they'll choose the below ground vegetation. So what happens on the border? Kind of the same thing, except all the hard substrate and the cage controls and the normal stuff, you know, they're just fine below ground. They get eaten significantly above ground, but again, the soft substrate gets totally hammered above and below ground, and in the high zone, really nothing's going. You see nothing significant happening above or below ground, except in the high zone. Even though we're 2 meters back from the where the crabs normally live, they found that soft substrate that they could burrow in and ate more than half of it below ground and had good access to the above ground stuff too. So when you soften the substrate, you accelerate the grazing. So in summary, crabs are unable to burrow or really have a big impact in hard substrate that protects the short stuff in the marsh from overgrazing. The crabs have a very narrow range of where, you know, they the home range. They stay pretty close to their burrows. We could go into a lot of detail on that, but when you see these marshes that have recovered now, there'll be this line of right at the high marsh, low marsh border, and that's basically their foraging distance. And then softening peat, you know, just allows this process to take off. And if you extrapolate that and look at what that really means, is that you know, when you add, you know, 50 years of sea level rise or about a vertical foot, you get only 8% marsh loss due to sea level rise, but you get an 86% increase in low marsh area, which is the stuff that's going to get eaten away by the. So you get a very strong synergistic effect, where either one of them separately is relatively benign, but you add them together, and you've got a really big problem. So sea level rise will synergistically increase herbivory marsh loss that far exceeds the estimates that people are talking about now. And kind of the big update to the old salt marsh paradigm is that overfishing, the trophic dysfunctionality that brings by shifting the food web around, eutrophication, which ramps up a lot of these processes, shifts around the competitive dominance of the plants, and climate change. Not even, you know, just looking at climate change from a sea level rise approach, forgetting about ocean acidification, interact to degrade salt marshes and the ecosystem surfaces they provide. And this is happening not just here, not just, I mean, that's, I was a little worried when I came in, everybody's talking about the East Wing and the West Wing. This is happening, you know, from Canada to the tip of South America, mm-hmm. you know, and up until 10 years ago, people were in total denial that this was going on. And our archival looking and reconstruction of the history here, this started happening as soon as World War II was over, and people started moving out of here and were driving out the art colonies, the writing colonies, and nudist colonies. You know, when tourism started after World War II, this started happening in the 70s. And about we see the first real strong, indisputable evidence of this in about 78, and then it really cranks up over time as the population mm-hmm. pressure, fishing pressure increases, and you get absolutely. These depleted areas. So this is what's going on in your backyard. It's a bigger problem than just out here where you live. It's a problem in the whole East Coast.
Would you say that it turned out that Sansarma is really the bad guy in all this?
I don't make values. I mean, it's
so
just
would some other critter or whatever be doing the herbivory if not for this?
No, not here. Not here. And in fact, there is a crab hero in this story, too. Because one of the things that happens, and for a while, we just couldn't know what the hell's going on here. Because, you know, once the crabs have been burrowing in a marsh for a decade or so, these burrows, which are big, you know, they start eroding away a little bit. So they start the openings just start eroding, getting a little larger and larger. And at a certain point, they get large enough so that green crabs, which aren't burrowers, and they typically don't live in salt marshes either, but they like being under something, you know, like, so they live on rocky shores under rocks, or they live in cracks and crevices. Salt marshes, they didn't have any place to go. They started living. So once you get the eroded structure and those openings to the old Sansarma burrows get big enough, they start living in there, and they don't eat the Sansarma; they scare them away. and it's like a smell thing and it's a visual thing. It's fear that drives them away. We can go laugh. Don't laugh. You know, I'll bet there's things that drive you away too. But we've done the experiments with this, with water treated with green crabs, or with the sight of them, and they run out as fast as they can. Yeah.
Then theoretically, wouldn't we expect to see more green crabs in the Westport River? But I don't think we see many. No, I'm just saying.
It takes a while. This doesn't happen.
I just think there's many fewer than when we grew up.
We used to have it.
Green crabs?
Yeah.
Maybe. Green. There's a lot of stuff's happened since you grew up. Well, it's a complicated question.
I have one more question.
What happened to the snapping turtle?
Here?
Didn't you say the turtle, what turtle was it that?
The terrapin?
Oh, yes.
In South Carolina.
Down in Georgia?
We had them here too, but.
Not in the.
Well, I mean, yeah, you can find them. You can find rare antiques too.
And nitrogen, does that have any effect on this?
Not on this.
Okay.
I mean, that was actually the first experiment we did at the Cape Cod National Seashore. I wanted to know that, answer to that question. And so we did a big experiment, big caging experiment, kind of like we did down south, but we added a fertilization treatment. Because most plant herbivore interactions are accelerated by fertilization. This wasn't. And it turns out that generates a lot of one of the things that I could not ever understand about some of the die-offs that we see going on here on Cape Cod, they're not anymore, but initially when things were just starting to get going, is you could walk across an area that was being affected, and except for peat density, substrate didn't seem to matter. And that didn't make any sense to me, because if you have high nitrogen substrate, there should be a pattern to that. I could find none. So, and then we did the experiment, and there was like no effect. I mean, when we did it with cattle in Chile, the same basic experiment that, you know, it did everything. When we did it with llama, it did everything. Mm-hmm. When we did it with snails, it did everything. You know, we found out, in fact, we found that in the south with the snails, if you could actually nucleate or start a die-off area, if you fertilized a small area. And what would happen, and this wouldn't happen overnight, wouldn't happen in a year, wouldn't happen in 2 years, but in about 3 years, what would happen is just over time, snails would bump into that area and stay in that area because the food was better, and their densities would go up high enough that then they would turn, initially, because these guys are fungal farmers, you know, the plants would do better for a while, and then boom, they would die. So those effects are there, but not on this that we looked. Yeah.
Have you written a second paper, or will you come back and give another talk about what we can do about it?
I don't know what you can do about it.
Stop fishing.
I wish I had a good
idea too.
What?
I do too.
Yeah. I think that this is a cyclical thing, but it's not a happy cyclical thing.
Well, the sea level rise is not.
Well, yeah, and also, you know, when these guys get into a marsh and take away the peat layer, and it either erodes away or calves away, and this can happen, you know, pretty rapidly, you know, it's eradicating hundreds of years of accretion. Yeah. These marshes are accreting at you know, like less than a centimeter a year, and when you see a chunk that high calve off a marsh, you just lost 400 years. So when it starts growing back in the sand, it's coming back, but it's not coming back like that for 400 years.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, I hope you get to that
I'll come back again. You got it figured out.
I'm sorry that we have to end. Yeah, I see Jim's question, but we're also bound by the library rules that we have to leave here at 8:30. So we don't need to move the chairs. I don't know if your question is a short one, Jim, or
it was just a question about sea level rise by itself.
Yeah.
Because the accretion level of the Marsh accretion is lower than the sea level rise, they're going to drown anyway. They're going to become more soft, right?
Well, that's still a little bit up in the air. I mean, I think that the natural accretion rate here in New England keeps up with sea level rise. As you move further south, that's no longer the case. But I mean, I'm not. You know, that's. I don't know if I believe that work or not. I mean, I'm not saying I don't. But people that work directly with that have that. That's a live hypothesis right now.
Professor, thank you for a very enlightening evening.
Yeah, thank you.